Nowadays, most of us take a relatively pure cold water supply for granted. 150 years ago, things were very different. Water was obtained directly from rivers, streams, springs, and wells. Its purity varied. In the growing towns of the 18th and 19th centuries, it was often of very dubious quality. In the Georgian period, prosperous classes often had a pipe supply from local sources. Pipes were made from lead or wood. Poor pipe seals and the lack of pumping power meant that water was only available at basement or possibly ground floor level. In this Georgian house, water was collected from the roof and hand pumped from a tank in the basement to a stone sink in the kitchen. The pipework and taps are a later Victorian addition. This lead-lined sink at first floor level would have originally been filled by jugs carried up from the kitchen. As towns grew in the mid-Victorian period, most large houses had a piped water supply. Cast iron pipes and steam engines provided the means to pump water to higher levels. WC and bathroom extensions soon appeared at the back of earlier properties. For the humbler classes, individual piped supplies were rare until the late 19th century. Water for washing and cooking often came from a communal standpipe served by a piped supply. The Victorians, albeit belatedly, recognised the need for a regular, clean supply of water. This reservoir, Blagden Lake, was opened in 1904. Water is collected from the surrounding Mendip Hills, its nature and quality affected by the type of ground it passes through. Minerals, chemicals, and various impurities are drawn into solution and may contaminate the reservoir water. To ensure the supply is safe to drink and pleasant to taste, treatment is required before distribution to the public. Reservoirs are usually formed by flooding a suitable valley and constructing a dam at the lower end. Dams can be made from earth, stone, or concrete. This one is a fairly modest structure, but some of them, particularly those in Wales and Scotland, are remarkable feats of engineering. Pumping stations located below the dam house powerful pumps which assist water flow onto the treatment works. Nowadays, the pumping station at Blagden contains powerful electric pumps. These pumps occupy much less space than their early steam counterparts. This has allowed the local water company to use part of the pumping house as a museum. Old photographs show how engineers provided the infrastructure for water collection and distribution. The works included large feats of civil engineering, building on the skills and experience gained during the construction of canals and railways. Original ledgers record the day-to-day running of the water system. Steam-driven beam engines were originally used for the removal of water from mining excavations, canal construction, and tunnels. Adapting them for pumping large quantities of water over long distances was a logical development. There were originally two engines at Blagdon, one of which remains for exhibition purposes. Sadly, it runs at reduced speed, driven by electrical power. The original coal-fired steam-generating boilers have long since disappeared. The tall chimney, nowadays no longer required, has been reduced in height for reasons of safety. The redundant water tanks which provided water for the steam engines have been put to good use. Breeding fish to restock the reservoirs provides a significant source of additional income and a valuable local amenity. Within 30 years of its construction, it was realised that Blagdon Lake couldn't meet the growing local demand for water. Just after the Second World War, another reservoir was formed a few miles away, Chew Valley Lake. It's a popular spot for walkers and bird watchers, and in the right conditions, a very popular spot for sailing. The level of water in the reservoir will obviously vary throughout the season. After a hot summer, it's quite low. An overflow controls the maximum level and directs surplus water down a culvert to local streams. Some natural cleansing occurs in reservoirs as sediment settles. It's the middle depth of water which is naturally the cleanest. To avoid sediment being lifted from the bottom, water is extracted at this middle level and pumped to the treatment works. To cope with the local terrain, Victorian engineers had to construct some of the pipeline above ground level. The design had to allow for problems of thermal expansion and contraction, which occur throughout the year. On arrival at the treatment works, the water is allowed to stand in large tanks so that some of the waterborne particles can settle as sediment. This process can take several weeks. Water from the tanks then flows through microstrainers. The microstrainers gradually remove debris and tiny algae present in the raw water. They can remove particles down to approximately 35 microns. If they start to block up, the drums automatically revolve faster to maintain the required flow. Jets of water directed at the top of the drums clean the meshes at each revolution. Having passed through the microstrainers, the water flows down a culvert and emerges in the centre of the slow sand filters. These remove remaining algae and other particles too fine for the microstrainers. Filters are cleaned every 70 days by draining the water and skimming off a thin layer from the surface of the sand. The dirty sand is then taken away and washed clean before being returned to the filter bed. The minimum effective depth of sand in the filter is about 0.5 metres. The green coating on the sand surface is a biologically active skin, often called Schmutzdecker. It helps to remove bacteria. Water in the sand filters runs down through the filter medium. It passes through fine-grained sand and the gravel bed below, and finally out through the channels at the base of the filter. The addition of chlorine in an underground tank kills any remaining bacteria. Constant monitoring ensures the biological purity of the water as it passes into the main supply. Other water sources include canals, rivers, boreholes, and springs. Underground water is generally a fairly clean source, but rivers may be more polluted and may require more extensive treatment. Conventional treatment plants, whilst providing satisfactory bacteriological quality, may not be able to remove certain tastes and odours. At this treatment works, raw water is taken from the canal, in this case fed by the River Severn, and is strained to remove debris. Oil is held back by a simple boom across the inlet channel. The water is then pumped to tanks and treated with ozone to remove bacteria and pesticides. This is a relatively new treatment, used here to reduce the water's earthy taste and the need for high levels of chlorine. The water then flows to coagulation tanks, where ferric sulfate is added to encourage the smaller particles to stick together, forming either scum or sediment. The scum and sediment are removed in the clarifiers. From here, the water flows to the rapid gravity sand filters. Cleaning these filters at regular intervals is achieved by reversing the flow of water and allowing the impurities to flow to waste. The filtered water travels to the next stage, where it's treated with ozone for a second time. After ozone treatment, the water is fed through activated carbon absorbers, which remove any remaining organic matter. In the final stage, chlorine is added. Only a tiny amount is needed to maintain water purity as it's pumped to local service reservoirs and on to the local distribution system. Once the water has left the treatment works, it remains in a sealed, sterile environment until it reaches the taps. The whole treatment process is constantly monitored to ensure the water is of the right quality. Clean drinking water travels from the treatment works to local storage systems or service reservoirs. These are often in the form of large underground tanks. Water towers are another option. The height of the water creates the necessary pressure to feed the local supply network. Getting water from its source to the taps involves a complex network of mains pipework. Pipes range in size from 1200 to 50 millimetres. The materials used for the manufacture of pipes have changed over the years. Cast iron, steel, concrete, pitch fibre, and more recently, plastic pipes have all been used. On a modern estate such as this, the water main is likely to be plastic. This and the other services or utilities are usually found in the pavement, in what's often referred to as a common user trench. The water main is deeper than the other utilities to avoid the risk of frost attack. At regular intervals along the main, washout valves are provided so that harmless sediment can be flushed out. Fire hydrants can also be provided. The water company is responsible for the pipework up to the boundary, but from the boundary to the house, it's the responsibility of the owner. New properties usually require an isolation valve in the pavement and a water meter just inside the boundary. A combined valve and meter is another option. The pipe enters the house through a duct. If less than 750 millimetres from the wall, it should be insulated. The incoming plastic pipe is vulnerable to rodent attack within buildings, so it's usual to change the material to copper just above floor level. After the pipe has been cut, a copper insert is pushed home. The insert prevents the pipe deforming as the compression fitting is tightened. Compression fittings contain a copper ring or olive. As the nut is tightened, the ring is squeezed against the pipe. An isolation valve or stopcock is then added. In hard water areas, a water softener can be included in the system to prevent the build-up of lime scale, which will affect the hot water system. Where water mains have adequate capacity, the pipework can feed each appliance directly from the mains. This is known as a direct supply.
Clean the fitting so there's no grease or soil on the inside of the fitting.
And also clean the pipe.
And apply flux,
which is used to stop the pipe oxidising.
This soldered joint is known as an end feed capillary fitting. Compression fittings can be used, but they're more expensive and fairly conspicuous. A quick wipe with a rag would have tidied up this joint. This alternative connector is known as a Yorkshire fitting. It contains two solder rings. Although slightly more expensive than end feed fittings, they're easier to fix and ensure exactly the right amount of solder. Plastic pipes are an alternative to copper, although they need extra support. Special push-on fittings can be used to form the joints. The pipe ends need to be strengthened with copper inserts to avoid deformation and leaks. If copper pipe is of the correct specification, it can be bent with the correct use of tools. Thin grades of pipe are unsuitable, as bending reduces the thickness of the pipe wall and causes crinkling. The first phase of work involves fixing the pipe runs. Connections to individual fittings are made when the plastering or dry lining is complete. Cold water pipework is only part of the copper installation. The rest of the pipework belongs to the hot water and central heating system. Hessian prevents pipe vibration and noise. Final connections are made when the sanitary fittings are installed. To facilitate maintenance of the installation, isolation valves and drain cocks are provided. Earth bonding cables are fixed to minimise the chance of electric shocks under fault conditions. This can occur, for example, where a live cable comes into contact with a copper pipe. In a direct supply, the risk of back siphonage can't be ignored. This can occur where a sudden drop in mains pressure sucks water back into the mains. It can be prevented by double check valves. Without this protection, a drop in mains pressure can contaminate the main system if, for example, a garden hose is dropped into a drain. Where a continuous water supply can't be guaranteed, drinking water is fed directly, but other fittings are supplied indirectly from a storage tank. Tanks, often referred to as cisterns, are available in a range of sizes and can help even out demands on the main supply. They're supported on softwood boards or sheet materials such as marine ply. Truss rafters are finely engineered and can easily be damaged by incorrect loading. Tanks of up to 230 litres can be supported on three trusses. Bearers running across the trusses should be located at the node points as shown. Additional bearers support the deck. They should be strong enough to resist deflection, which may damage the pipe connections. The cistern is fed by the rising main, in this mock-up, 15mm copper. An isolating valve allows for any necessary maintenance. A ball floating valve controls the amount of water entering the cistern. As water is drawn off, the float drops and opens the valve. Normal water level in the cistern must be well below the valve to avoid the risk of back siphonage into the main system. To prevent flooding caused by a faulty valve or hold float, an overflow or warning pipe is fitted in between valve level and water level. It must be of a larger diameter than the rising main and should discharge outside the roof in a prominent position. The water in the distribution pipe will be at a lower pressure than the main. To ensure adequate flow to the fittings, it should therefore be of larger diameter, in this example, 22mm. To reduce the risk of contamination, the cistern should have a close-fitting lid and be designed to exclude light and insects. The cistern and its connecting pipework should be insulated. To provide some warmth, the ceiling insulation should be omitted immediately below the cistern. This film has briefly looked at cold water supplies. Another film in the series examines hot water supply and distribution.